The Tao of Self-Confidence, Episode 659.
Welcome to The Tao of Self-Confidence, where I share stories of amazing women who have discovered their inner journey to self-confidence. Visit our website at thetaoofselfconfidence.com. Your inner journey to self-confidence awaits.
Well, hello, friend. Welcome to The Tao of Self-Confidence, where I share stories of amazing women who have discovered their inner journey to self-confidence. I'm your host today, Sheena Yap Chan, and today I have a phenomenal lady on the show today. She's a writer and also a mental health advocate, and I'm really excited to have her on and share her story with us today on self-confidence. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Michelle Yang. Michelle, how are you today? Maybe you can fill in a little bit more about yourself to the listeners.
Yeah, sure. Thank you for having me on the show, Sheena. Yeah, so I have been a mental health advocate for the past several years, but actually I've been hiding my diagnosis because of the fear of stigma up until just a few months ago. And so it's been extremely freeing to suddenly be able to really advocate for myself because, you know, otherwise I was kind of doing it through my support group and through my organizations, but with the rest of my world, my circles, I was in hiding about it. And it was really an experience that kept me small. And so I'm really happy to kind of reclaim my power.
Awesome. And thanks for sharing that. I think that's something we all go through, like hiding something like this because we feel shameful or feel like, you know, nobody knows what we're going through. We feel alone in this journey, not realizing so many people go through it. And just, you know, that action of just sharing your story can really help someone out there. So I'm really glad you're able to come out of it and, you know, have the courage to share your story regardless of the outcome. And Michelle, what's your cultural background?
Yeah, I'm ethnic Chinese and I was born and raised in Korea. And then I immigrated to the States when I was 9.
Awesome. Well, thanks for sharing that. And what'd be your favorite self-confidence quote?
I came across this recently, but it's just been such a part of my own journey as well. It's, you can't advocate for yourself if you won't admit what you are. And it's from the book Shrill by Lindy West. And of course, there's that Who show now, and it's really blown up. But I identify it with it so deeply because, like I said, I was hiding my diagnosis for so long. I live with bipolar disorder, and people have such, you know, misconceptions about what that means. And people never would expect somebody like me. I have a master's degree. I was in this, you know, really coveted corporate role, and I have a family, a beautiful family, and I'm a really happy person. So people just did not expect. Usually people think bipolar disorder and somebody who is a complete mess and undependable. And I realized that I am in a position to be able to advocate that there are other people like me who are living really well and taking care of themselves and their families, but then they're in hiding because they don't want to be associated with this extremely negative stigma. I just want to say that everybody with this condition and other mental health illnesses, you know, it can vary greatly. And there's no one type of, you know, way to be because you have bipolar disorder. And I'm just here to advocate for more understanding and compassion.
Thanks for sharing that great quote. And, you know, it's crazy, right? We never know what a person's going through. We think, you know, on the outside, they look perfect. They look like they have it all together. But you never know, right? There's always something behind closed doors. And, you know, sometimes it's just knowing that we're all going through something just makes us feel like we're not alone in this journey, that we can get through this together, right? Side by side. And, you know, we can conquer everything, anything, right? But like you mentioned in your quote, you have to admit that there's something that's going on, right? If you don't admit it, you can't advocate it. And especially as Asian women, you know, we've always been programmed to never tell anyone what's wrong with us, right? Always have to put up that face like everything's great, right? Not realizing we're dying on the inside. So I'm really glad that you're able to share that. And in your own words, how do you define self-confidence?
To me, self-confidence is being truly at peace with yourself. You know, embracing all of who you are. And that also means not feeling like you need to apologize for taking up space and not apologizing or giving disclaimers for giving your opinion. This, you know, it means to really be able to successfully dispel any negative thoughts that you have about yourself, you know, trying until there's as little negative thoughts as possible, you know, in your head so that you can be your own advocate and champion.
Thanks for sharing that great definition. And Michelle, what was your life like before your discovery of self-confidence?
Yeah, I was a lot more self-conscious about myself. I, you know, at work, even though I was in this great company that was, you know, really well respected, and I had this great role. For example, public speaking always terrified me because when I felt seen, it just made me feel really small. And because, you know, when before I discovered this self-confidence, before I could come out with the fact that I'm bipolar, if people said insensitive things around me, especially at work, that meant I couldn't stand up and fight for myself. You know, like people would say things like, oh, my boss is so bipolar, or the weather is acting so bipolar, or, you know, just saying insensitive things. And I couldn't say like, hey, that's not really how that works. And actually, I have bipolar disorder. And it's a real condition that is quite a struggle. And, you know, I wish you wouldn't put it that way. I was silenced, you know, and I kind of was always felt stunned silent whenever I was in those kind of positions, and they ate away at me. And I was often filled with self-doubt. And, you know, really, when you have a skeleton in the closet for as long as I had, because I was diagnosed when I was 20 and I just came out, I'm 37, you know, so it was eating me up inside. I always felt like if somebody really found out that this was what I am, that I have this bipolar condition, but then they would not like me anymore, that they would fire me, or, you know, I was just afraid of the consequences of what it was like. So when I actually took control of the message and am advocating for myself, it was definitely so freeing.
Thanks for sharing that. And was there any other moments in your life when you realized, you know, you can be who you are, even, you know, you were diagnosed with being bipolar, right? Having that courage to go out there and just show your true self, you know, have that confidence. If you have any aha moments?
Yeah. So, you know, I was at this job. I had been there for several years, doing great. I'd just gotten promoted. And then I had a moment of, how did I end up here? Because, you know, I was making more money than I had ever had before, but I was so miserable. I was drained and I did not have enough energy left for my family in the way that I wanted to be, you know, and I was finding it impossible to prioritize my mental health. You know, I was just having so much anxiety. It was keeping me up at night. And so that was kind of my aha moment. Like, why am I here? Like, who am I trying to please? Because we have enough money to live, you know, and money isn't everything. I've never been somebody who was driven by money first. And so I just really had a moment of, you know, epiphany, if you will, of like trying to analyze, like, why am I doing this to myself? And, you know, and I asked, like, could I have continued? Sure. You know, I could absolutely have continued in that role and been successful, but I realized it just wasn't the way I wanted to live. It didn't matter that I had worked up to that role for so many years. I needed to make a change to really live the life I want.
Thanks for sharing that. And I think we all go through that, right? You know, we go after that status of success, you know, having the fancy cars, the fancy house, the six-figure job. But, you know, sometimes you sit there and you realize like there's something more to, like there's something out there that's more than that, right? You know, you have a bigger purpose and you're meant to live a different type of life. And, you know, it kills us because we don't know if, you know, are we supposed to follow what people tell us or you go your own way? And, you know, going your own way is not always easy. You know, it's definitely challenging, but it's totally worth it, right? Like what you did, you just decided, like, why am I doing this? Is it for me or is it for somebody else, right? And yeah. When we can ask those type of questions, we can figure out, you know, what we really want in life. And because of your realizations, what's your life been like now?
Yeah, you know, it's been so great. I've been saying I am happier than I've ever been before. I have been finding luckily a lot of success with my writing. I think it's resonating. I have a couple articles that has been accepted by HuffPost and Hello Giggles and NAMI, which is the National Alliance on Mental Illness, who I've been volunteering for the past several years as a support group facilitator, has really supported me as well. And they've published my writing both on their national site and on their local chapter here. And I'm just really proud of it. And every time I connect with someone who really needs the message that I have, it's really validating that I am on the right path. You know, but I couldn't have done it without doing this work myself for years, without going to the support group for years, because I had a lot of internalized stigma against mental illness myself that I had to work through and that I needed to make peace with. So, you know, but even though when I came out, so it was only late January, early February when I decided to like announce, write publicly about my mental health, I'm, you know, still hit with doubt regularly. I have waves of panic of like, what did I do? You know, and what if I never find a real paying job again, you know, because of this, if they, you know, I'm out online as somebody who lives with a mental health condition and who's advocating, which, by the way, is like completely unfair since I'm the same hardworking, you know, person that I've always been with all the same qualifications. But, you know, by and large, my community have been so, so supportive. And I've really found that a strong sense of confidence, a newfound sense of confidence and self-assurance that I actually didn't expect for some reason. I don't know if I just didn't process that far of like what this would mean for me when I actually came out. But I find myself, you know, doing things that I thought I would be too afraid to do, like speaking on podcasts, you know, because I never thought of myself as an articulate person, you know, thinking of my corporate job where I always found myself often tongue-tied in front of senior vice presidents, you know, and so I'm like, it's just because I'm passionate about this topic. This is, you know, the change that I want to make in the world. And so I really do feel like I've found my calling later in life, but, you know, here I am.
Thanks for sharing that. And it's amazing what happens when you can just share your story out there. I know it's terrifying sometimes because you never know who might be judging us or, you know, what the outcome might be. But, you know, it just surprises us how many people support what we do and how thankful they are for sharing your story out there, because they know that, you know, because you have the courage to share it, even though you're going through something really, really challenging in your life. Just the fact that you can share it out there can be grateful, right? I'm sure so many people send you messages saying, thank you so much for sharing your story and what they've been through, right? It's crazy. But sometimes for me, if it's like, if you can help one person, that makes a huge difference in the world. So I'm really glad you're able to out there and you're able to go out there and share your story to the world. And, you know, to the woman who's listening to your episode, she may be in her own journey to self-confidence. What would be that one tip you would give to her?
Be kind to yourself and be patient. You know, don't apologize for who you are and the things that things are usually never as bad as they are in your head. And I would, you know, because I think we are often our own harshest critic, and we're hardest on ourselves. And I've found that it helps to kind of imagine yourself a step away and like look at yourself as if, you know, you're giving advice to your best friend instead of that's you yourself. I found that to be really helpful. That forces us to be kinder to ourselves. I also really encourage therapy and support groups when it's applicable, because, you know, we women experience a lifetime of conditioning, especially I think Asian American women, because we're really demanded to conform to ideals of beauty, and our society dictates the type of personality that is acceptable for women and even the type of job, you know, sometimes. And our right to take up space has been challenged our whole lives, and it will take time and a lot of hard work to reverse that conditioning. So the first step is realizing that the way that we've been programmed all our lives, it's not the only way to be a woman. And then that it's up to us then, once you have that realization, to really do the hard work and to heal and to take back our power so that we can reach self-actualization.
Thanks for sharing those great tips. And if our listeners wanted to get to know a little bit more about you and what you do and check out some of your work, is there any links or social media profiles we can connect with?
Yeah, sure. I have a blog called livingwellhappily.com. And you can also find me on Facebook at Michelle Yang Writer or Instagram at the same handle, Michelle Yang Writer. And also, actually, I am a lifestyle editor and contributor for Mochi Magazine, which is an online publication that focuses on empowering young Asian American women. And that's really my, you know, my target people, right? I'm an Asian American woman, I'm an immigrant. And so I would love to help, you know, send the message that, you know, we shouldn't suffer alone, that we should take back our power. So Mochi Magazine can be found at mochimag.com.
Thanks for sharing that. And to our listeners, if you want to connect with Michelle, you can also head on over to the taoofselfconfidence.com and search for Michelle's name. Her show notes will pop up along with everything else that we talked about. And I really just want to thank Michelle for taking the time to share her story and tips with us on self-confidence. So thank you so much, Michelle.
Thank you so much, Sheena. Thank you for doing this great show.
Thanks again. Well, no problem. It was really great having you on the show. And to our listeners, be on the lookout for another new episode of Another Amazing Woman's Journey to Self-Confidence, and we'll talk to you soon. Bye for now.
Bye.
Thank you for tuning in to another amazing episode of The Tao of Self-Confidence. Please subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts or Spotify to get your daily boost of confidence.